Right, this is Monday, October 20, 2014. We're at 6 p.m., and this is the Committee on Ways and Means. I have Councilor Napolitano.
Here.
I got Councilor Hanlon.
Here.
I got Councilor Capone.
Here.
I got Councilor Della Shola.
Here.
I have Councilor DeFlorio.
Here.
We have 5 members present. We do have a quorum.
If we could please rise and say the Pledge of Allegiance. Could the clerk read the first item of business?
All right, the first item of business is actually the monthly warrants, which being... All right.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Item number two, this is an order by Councilor Michael K. Marchese as president, that the City Council rescind the local option chapter 653, section 40 of the Acts of 1989.
Thank you. Could we have the assessor and the auditor please come up? Could you please state your name for the record?
Pamela Davis, City Assessor.
Richard Viske, City Auditor.
And for the public, could you tell us what Chapter 653, Section 40 is?
Yes. 653 Section 40 was a local option that was passed in the 80s when we were all falling on very economic hard times. And what this chapter did was allow us to pick up extra growth, which converts to a levy amount you can raise above 2.5. And it is capturing all the new construction that took place within that year. And when you take the value of that, multiply it by the prior year rate, and that gives you a dollar figure that you can raise above 2.5. So most all our laws have January 1 as our assessment date. So to give everybody an extra edge, if they so chose to adopt this option, they changed the construction date to June 30. So you could pick up an extra 6 months of construction. And what that did was it gave you additional funds for that 1 year, but from then on, you're on a July 1 to June 30 basis, so you're back to picking up only 12 months of construction. The reason I think it's important we change that and go back to the January 1 date is, number one, we are currently at the levy ceiling, so the amount of growth we have is irrelevant because we're at the levy ceiling. So it's not going to hurt us to lose 6 months of growth for this 1 year. The second reason is it will allow us, in being able to pick up construction as of January 1, it'll allow us to finish our values much earlier. So when you're in budget discussions, we can give you estimated tax rates because we are going to know what the values are. Right now, you're going to have a classification hearing and we can tell you about what the rates are going to be, but everything is in flux, because we're that far behind having to pick up that extra 6 months worth of building permits. I hope I said that well. I know it's kind of complicated.
Councilman Hanlon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think I get it.
Okay.
The thing is that this is going to be a one-time occurrence.
Well, it's a one-time vote, and it is a one-time occurrence as far as only picking up 6 months of building permits. Mm-hmm. But after that, we're back to 12 months of building permits.
Right, so it'll be 12 months, except it's a different time period?
It'll be January to January instead of right now, we're on July to June.
Right, and I understand that. So what we're really gaining, we're going to get like for 1 year, we're going to have 18 months?
No.
No?
You're going to have 6 months. you're coming back to January 1.
If you vote this yeah.
for fiscal 16, we're only going to be looking at 6 months of building permits. We're okay. going to be looking at July 1 of this year to December 31st of this year. But like I said, even though that's usually a concern everybody's radar is on, we're at the levy ceiling. So how much growth we have is irrelevant. Mm-hmm. We can only raise what's on the other side of the equation, the levy ceiling.
Okay. Okay.
Now, I do feel this is going to be our only year of opportunity because values are appreciating like crazy. And what's going to happen is it's going to take us out of the levy ceiling. So we're going to be back to relying on growth as a key component to get the budget we want to get. So that's why this vote would be crucial to be the vote. Any other time, it's going to hurt us as far as what we can raise in the budget.
Okay. I had thought that this 6 months would be added on to what we've already had.
No, it was in the beginning when you chose to pick that up.
Okay.
That gave you the 18 months.
Okay.
So
okay.
to reject it, you got to give that 6 month back.
Okay, gotcha. All right, okay, perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, through you. All right, so I'm still trying to grab it, so.
I know, it's very complicated.
Can I try?
So now we're at the, sure.
Oh, basically, for example, we had about over $1 million worth of new growth last year, but because we were at the levy ceiling, we were unable to increase our levy limit. So accelerating growth when you're in a levy ceiling situation is bad because we can never get that growth again. So by slowing it down 6 months and values actually raising up, we'll actually have a better shot of adding that money to the levy limit. Once upon a time, we got 18 months of growth when we passed this law. To reverse it, we would shorten it 1 year. We'd only have 6 months of growth. But this is the time period you want to do 6 months of growth because we're at the levy ceiling. Because once we get out of that levy ceiling, we want to be able to capture that 12 months of growth.
Right.
So it's kind of a unique opportunity for this community at this point.
Plus the added benefit is having our values done much earlier in the year.
Okay. And as far as the actual billing, now this growth permits people doing work, et cetera, these are the individuals that are going to bear the expense on those taxes.
Well, they're not going to really.
Those who have done work, is it dollar for dollar with the folks that are having work done?
It's not going to impact final values. What
right.
it's going to do is impact just for this 1 year of depending on when they took the building permit out, when mm-hmm. it's going to hit their bill.
Okay. And that's
and it's
my
just
question.
This
when,
1 year.
When does that hit their bill? Is it within the same fiscal year? Is
well,
it the
right
next
now,
available
what
quarter?
We're picking up is building permits from July 1, 13 to June 30, 14. And they're going to be on the fiscal 15 bill.
Okay.
The bill they get in December is going to all those values are going to reflect that.
Okay.
What we're proposing you do is reject 653, so we're back to a January 1 assessment date. So now we're going to be looking at anybody that took a building permit out from July 1, 14 to December 31, 14.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to see that activity on their bill that they get in December of 15.
Okay. All the activity will fall in that quarter.
Right.
Okay.
Those that we would have picked up from January 15 to June 30, 15, we'll be picking them up from January 15 to December 31st, 15 for fiscal 17.
Okay. So everybody's
going to be reflected. It's just you're changing the assessment
right.
date.
Is there going to be, or is there the possibility that when you're capturing that growth and it's hitting on that bill, everything's going to squarely fall in the quarter? Is it going to be something that's excessive as opposed to being able to spread it out over quarters?
No, it's still
going to
be spread out over the quarters.
Okay,
everything
so
will be the same.
So reflect the number, but it'll be spread out.
It's not changing the billing process at all.
Okay.
All we're doing is capturing a different segment of building permits for each bill.
Okay.
But nothing else is changing.
And then going forward, it would be January to January?
Yes.
And that way you'd have a better idea of what you're looking at for finances, so that when you are setting up the budget at the end of the fiscal year, you have more realistic numbers as opposed to guessing.
Right.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Are there any other questions? Councilor Hamlin.
So how does this affect the single-family, double, triple-family homeowners? Where is that going to come?
It only affects them if they took out a building permit.
Okay. So they won't be seeing an increase in tax bills. I mean, some people have asked me these questions, you know, and I said, I don't think so, but
I don't know. Well, anybody that pulls a building permit, at some point in time, we're going to be capturing that activity.
Yes.
Now, sometimes building permits make a negative value. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, they make a positive right. value.
So we just want to try to let people know is that what we're talking about, capturing this other thing, only affects the people that we're capturing.
Right.
It doesn't affect people that have nothing to do with it. So their taxes aren't going to be.
Everything is the same. Everything really is the same. All we're doing is we're saying, instead of going from July to June for building permits, mm-hmm. we're going to go back to January to December.
Right. No, I understand. I just want to make that clear so people that are listening will know it. Okay.
Any other questions?
Will they be excused with the customary thanks, Mr. Chairman?
Wait a second.
Second. Where is? Are they going to be coming up for the other pieces? It might be easier for them just to stay seated.
Okay. The obvious.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for favorable action on it.
Yep, for it out as favorable. I'll second
motion
that.
For favorable action, seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Clerk will read item number 3.
All right. Item number 3. This is also an order by Councilor Michael K. Marchese as president, that the sum of $815,320 be appropriated into the other post-employment benefits liability trust funds.
Councilman Capone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Through you to our guest. If you don't mind, why don't you just give a general overview of what it is exactly we're doing with this account, what items are affected by it, what kind of funds are in there in terms of a balance, and what, if anything, we're expending, either however you calculate it, monthly, quarterly, semi-annually?
Sure, absolutely.
Thank you.
As you probably are aware, the Department of Revenue has come in and they audited our balance sheet and certified our free cash in the amount of $5.4 million. They also certified our Water and Sewer Enterprise Fund retained earnings for $259,000. As part of the budget process and your budget documents that you received back in April, we laid out some financial reserve policies. And in those policies, we basically take 50% of our free cash, which is one-time revenue source, and we appropriate it to particular accounts, one of which is the stabilization, one of which is the other post-employment benefit liability trust fund, and the capital improvement. And we've broken it out in a way that we're putting 15% into the stabilization account, 15% into the other post-employment benefit liability trust account, and 20% into the capital improvement trust account. So those are the three numbers that you'll see before you. I believe the first one that you just took up was the post-employment benefits. Just to give you a refresher, the audience, whoever's watching, that is the account that we set up so that we can pay the health insurance benefits of the retirees of the city. There's a liability that's calculated by actuaries. It's about $145 million. We're not required to fund this by law at this point. However, it's a very hot topic with this Commonwealth and the bond rating agencies, and they want cities and towns to begin to at least acknowledge the fact that these are true liabilities and fund that account. So you may recall last year, the council adopted the law to start the trust account. We made an initial last year we appropriated, I believe it was $778,000. It's up to $800,000 with the earned interest, and we're proposing again that we put 15% of our free cash into this fund. It's a way to fund this account without building into the budget and burdening the taxpayers, but still addressing the need that we have to fund the OPEB, at least for this particular appropriation order.
Okay, thank you for the overview. As far as other benefits, is it strictly health insurance? Is that all that is?
I mean, it's health, dental, and life, but I think the city doesn't have a contributory plan for dental insurance, so it really is just, I'd say, 99% health insurance, and there's a small life insurance benefit that the city picks up a portion of.
In what is the actual balance now? You said about
$800,610 to be exact.
$800,610. All right, we appropriated about $778, so it's grown by about 20 some odd. You said $145 million is the obligation. That's the obligation over what? Or got a different number or no?
No, the way I try to explain it to keep it, to get your arms around, is that if the city stopped operating today, mm-hmm. how much would it cost to insure
okay.
all the retirees until the last person died that actually works here today? Because
okay.
it's not only the retirees, it's the active people that will
eventually
retire.
Will become retirees.
And the actuaries are the ones who do all the assumptions that get, they forecast it out, they discount the number back, and they've come up with $145 million as our liability.
How frequently does the city disperse funds?
This money will probably never be dispersed. This is just us saving up money to show that we're funding this trust. I mean,
okay.
if we ever were to tap into these funds at all, it could only be used to pay the portion of retirees' health insurance benefits.
Okay. What is that figure right now? What are we paying out as a city for retirees' benefits?
I think about the $18 million appropriation for health insurance, I'd say about 35% of it is for the retirees. I'd have to go back and get that breakdown. But
in how frequently is that dispersed? Is that monthly?
We pay a monthly health insurance warrant that okay. Medex is the primary plan, but there's other plans, part
right,
of our health insurance trust.
So you believe 35% of the current liability?
I believe it breaks out about $6 million is the actual retiree portion of that.
Okay.
Their benefits are actually, it costs a little less because of the Medicare that kicks in, and it's a supplemental okay. plan.
So this is a savings account to leverage against our obligation. No funds have been taken out of there?
No funds have been taken out of there.
If they were, I mean, it would have to come before the council in order to remove funds, shift them around?
Yes. As a matter of fact, this trust is an irrevocable trust. So this isn't, the other trust accounts that you adopted for the capital stabilization mm-hmm. account and the employee buyback, you can repurpose that with 2/3 vote. This okay. trust is a permanent trust, and okay. the only money that could ever be appropriated out of it is for the benefit of the retirees. And I don't foresee that being the case ever. This should just grow and grow. And what we've tried to do is we've tried to put in a policy that will allow us to fund it every year.
Mm-hmm.
In some manner. I mean, we may not always have $5.4 million of free cash.
Sure.
We may get $500,000, but then at least we can put in $50,000. You know, yeah. at least the bond agencies and the Department of Revenue like to see that you
Absolutely.
Adopt a policy and follow a policy, and that's what we're doing.
This
particular year just happens to be good news. We have a healthy free cash number, so we're able to put a healthy amount of money in there.
It's being fiscally responsible.
I like to think so.
You've got, quote unquote, what you would consider some sort of an opportunity, a windfall, pull some aside, put it in the savings bank. Can't be used for any other purpose. It's a good place to put it. The obligation is only going to get larger. It's not going to get smaller, I don't think. But you know, some folks will eventually pass away, but others are going to retire every year. So it's always going to be an obligation we have. So I appreciate the overview. I appreciate the answers. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Councilman Hamlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If we were to achieve a goal of $145 million in that fund, this fund would be gaining interest, correct?
Oh, yes.
Okay. So the interest on that fund, I mean, if we go over the $145 million, could that money be reverted back to pay part of the expenses for the medical for the retirees?
I think at the point that it's fully funded, you can actually take 100% of the money out of that trust to pay for the retirees' health insurance, because that's really the purpose of that fund, is to do that.
But
right now, most communities are pay-as-you-go. I mean, I would say, safe to say, every community now is pay-as-you-go.
Right.
There's not many if any communities at all that have started this and started to put money into it and then turned to start taking money out. It doesn't, at this point, it's too new to have that make any sense. I mean, if there was 85 million in it and it was 145, maybe you could say, oh, we could take a million. It's a tough time. We had state aid cuts, et cetera, but this is really meant to be kind of a trust fund that money is just going into to represent that you're aware of this obligation. The GASB came up with GASB 65, and this is that OPEB liability, and we're addressing it.
I know the 145 million will fluctuate also. You know, I mean,
it will go to, yeah. I mean, that's all based upon how many people run the plans, what the plan benefit structure is, and
right.
the age bracket, et cetera.
Uh-huh.
It's all done through an actuary. We have to do a biannual actuarial study, and we're in the process of doing one for January 1st right now. So we should have a new OPEB liability number. I'm hoping it goes down. There are some indications that it may go down because of the fact that we changed our health insurance benefits a couple years ago with the through the legislature. We were able to adopt the law and get rid of Master Medical, et cetera.
When you just said that, the $145 million, if we ever achieve that, we could take all of that, but
well, I think that if you had a $6 million health insurance cost for retirees and your OPEB was fully funded, you would just take the $6 million right out of the trust as opposed
right,
to out of an
right.
appropriation.
But then wouldn't you have to put it back in to get back up to the $145 million or as near as you could to what you figured we'd have to be paying in the future?
Yeah, I would imagine once you took it out and then you may only be 97% funded. Again, there could be a case where in some pensions back when the market was good, there were some retirement systems that actually were 105% funded. But they
right.
kind of
yeah.
got in
yeah.
trouble because
yeah.
they ignored it.
Yeah.
And then when the market crashed, they went from 105% funded to 80% funded in 1 year. So it's kind of far down the road to imagine that we'd be in that scenario. But I think the policy is the policy. And as you get closer to being fully funded, you adjust those policies as such.
So our retirement system is based on the same exact policy.
Yeah, the
right?
difference between the retirement obligation and the OPEB obligation is that the state has mandated that all retirement systems are funded by 2040. But they haven't mandated OPEB.
Okay.
But something tells me some point in time they're going to pass a law that says that communities are required to fund OPEB.
Okay.
But most communities are now taking a proactive approach, adopting a trust and using free cash as a mechanism. Some people fund it right out of the appropriation. I think Wellesley did an override to fund theirs. I mean, certain people do certain things.
But we appropriate the money to pay for the medical decides, too, don't we?
Yeah, this is just kind of socking money away to address this unfunded, this liability, this actuarial liability.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Councilman Dalzo.
Councilman Hamlin answered my question, but the other question, it is only for retirement, nothing with 401 and all that stuff.
This is only
for the retirement, correct?
This is only for the health insurance benefits of the retirees that are eligible to receive them. So basically anyone as of today, anyone who works 10 years in a municipality, once they hit retirement age, is eligible to receive municipal health insurance. So they take all the employees and say, oh, what percentage of these people are going to work here 10 years? 90%, okay. What percentage are male? How long are they going to live? How long are the firemen going to live? How long are the cops going to live? How long are the accountant's going to live?
Right.
Oh, this guy, he's going to die when he's 70. This one's going to die when he's 100. So then they present value it back, and they come up with this absurd large number. It says, right now you need $145 million to fund this. Some people will say, well, the city's never going out of business. What's the big deal? But this is the government accountant standards board that brings
right.
us up, and we're just trying to appease what they've adopted as a standard. And it looks good, and like I said, AA bond rating, that this stuff helps. They look at that. It means a lot to them. They see that if we can put $1 million a year into this OBEB trust and the market is earning this interest and all the interest is going back to the fund, we can start showing that, hey, we're making some headway on this.
Do you know the surrounding cities, do you know what they're doing right now, like Malden and Revere? And
I don't know. I mean, I could try to pull and get some information, or the Department of Revenue might have some information on that, but I don't know for sure. I mean, some people have adopted the trust and put $1 in it just to have it there so they're ready to put money in when
right,
they have
right.
it. Others are doing it more aggressively. Some people argue, why are we funding this one where we still got 70% to put towards our retirement assessment? So I'm trying to balance it out so that it's, we've acknowledged it, we have a funding, it's kind of a modest, 15% of free cash, I believe, is a modest and a manageable amount, and this is the second year we're doing it, but we went from $0, you know, 12 months ago, and we'll be up to $1.7 million next month if this appropriation goes through, so I think it's, I think we're moving in the right direction.
So one year could be 15%, and one year could be...
Well, it's always going to be 15%, but it might be 15% of $2 million. It might be 15% of $15 million. I don't, you know.
Exactly.
With any luck, we'll have healthy free cash, and we'll just be able to plug away, not at just this, but all of our financial reserves.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Councilman Capone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One follow-up question. What's the portion that the city pays for retired employees' benefits for health? Do you know the percentage?
For the most part, it's 85%. Okay. But there are some employees that I think pre-1999, and the city picks up 98%.
Yeah, much more.
So at one point, they grandfather those people in. But all retirees that retire now, it's an 85-15 split, which is the same for the actives. 85-15 is a split citywide.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Any further questions? Okay. Councilman Hanlon?
Quick answer. That's not just the retirees, that's their family too, right? That are covered?
It's usually just the husband and it's a husband and spouse or a wife and spouse. It's not children, so it's either a one and one or just a one.
Thank you. Gentlemen, your pleasure.
Gentlemen,
if we could ask him a second, he's on the last two pieces as well.
Sure. Vote out favorably.
Second.
Okay, we motion for favorable action, recommendation for favorable action, and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Clerk will read item number 4.
Item number 4. This order of by Council Michael K. Marchese as president, that the sum of $1,087,093 be transferred and appropriated into the Capital Improvement Stabilization Fund.
Councilman Capone?
Wow, you're fast. You got there so quick.
All in favor?
Aye.
Councilman Capone?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If you would, for the benefit of those watching at home as well as in this room, could you explain the difference between Capital Improvement Stabilization Fund and the Stabilization Fund itself, which is the next piece?
Sure. About 10 years ago, the Department of Revenue allowed cities and towns to adopt a law to create multiple stabilization accounts. So there used to be one stabilization account, and everyone put their money into that one kind of cover-all stabilization account to use for any legal purpose with a two-thirds vote of the city council. There was some people who would like to have created some stabilization accounts for specific purposes, so that the legislature passed a law that allowed for multiple stabilization accounts. So last year, as part of our budget process, we asked the council to adopt that law to create two stabilization accounts, one for capital improvement and one for employee leave buyback. So two-thirds vote was required to set this account up. And the voting, any money in or out of that fund is also a two-thirds vote. I believe in, definitely out.
Yeah.
The free cash vote in, I think, only requires a majority vote. Yeah. But this, unlike the OPEB, could be changed. The purpose of this fund could be changed with a two-thirds vote of the city council. So if there were no capital needs in the city and everything was up to snuff and you wanted to use this for, you know, something else, you could propose that and change the purpose. But right now, I don't think that, I think everyone knows that there's plenty of capital needs in the city. And this is just another way of us to say, okay, we're going to create a stabilization account. We're going to put some money in it. The interest stays within this account. And then when we roll out the capital plan next year, we may want to ask the council to vote some of this money to fund some of these projects. So this is just another way of showing that on our balance sheet we have some healthy financial reserves, and these are for specific purposes. So last year we adopted the stabilization account. We put $500,000 in there. There's still $500,000 in there. This would bring it up to $1.5 million. If this appropriation goes through and it funds this account, come the spring when we propose fiscal year 16 capital improvement plan, we may seek to use some of these dollars for some of those capital purposes. But right now, the purpose of this vote is just to put some more money in there.
If you could give an example or two of capital improvement type of programs that are necessary that we'd be looking at.
Oh, it could be a roadways project. It could be infrastructure repairs for buildings. It could be a roof. It could be vehicles, equipment, snow plows, anything. The capital plan says that capital item is something that has 5 years of useful life or longer and has a value of $25,000 or more. So anything else I would consider an operational cost. So the first requirement of anyone asks for anything in the capital improvement budget, they have to meet those two 5 years, $25,000 in value.
Okay, great, thank you.
Any other questions? Your pleasure.
For the item out favorably.
Okay, we have a motion for favorable action. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Clerk will read item number five.
And item number five. This is an order of my counsel, Michael K. Marquez, as president, that the sum of $815,320 be appropriated into the stabilization fund.
Councilman Hyland, did you have your hand up?
Yes.
Okay.
So as we understand it now, we have a capital improvement stabilization fund, and then this fund must be for everything else?
This is your general rainy day fund, I guess,
so
as they call it.
So use it for in case the wind is blow out in a hurricane or the exit.
Any legal expenditure with a two-thirds vote of the council.
Okay. Anything, it doesn't matter.
Any legal appropriation.
Is there money in it now?
There's a few bucks in there.
$2?
No, a few. No, it's $10.66 million in there right now.
$10.66 million.
Yes.
$10.6 million. And then we're going to add $815,000 to it?
I hope so.
Okay.
Councilman Capone?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The last couple of years, budget years, what kind of money has gone out of the stabilization fund?
I believe the only vote we had out of stabilization was, since I've been here, was just to fund a shortfall in state aid. When we presented the budget, we used the governor's number, and the House and Senate voted a much lower number. Okay. And we used some of that stabilization money, but then we put it right back in, so it was a temporary use of those funds. Again, this is the rainy day fund is just that, you know, if it's raining, some of the policies that we set forward to say, when would we use this money? If net state aid receipts is reduced by the average of the prior 2 years, when local receipts are down 3%, when there's a catastrophic or an emergency event that can't be supported by a general fund appropriation, those are the types of things that we'd come before you and ask you for. But we have this balance that we have right now is another reason why we're a double A rated community. It's a $10.6 million. We have a taxing capacity of about $90 million, so we have about 11% of our tax capacity in a stabilization account, not to include these other accounts. So it's a good thing. It's I'm sure many communities are jealous of our position with that, and we have a goal of funding target level of the general fund operating budget was $145 million. I'd like to have 10% of that, which is $14.5 million as a goal. So we're almost at that goal. If we hit that goal, then these policies may change, and we may only put 10% of our free cash in stabilization. Maybe we'll start to squirrel more away for capital projects or for the OPEB or some other issue that may come up. So these policies will evolve as we get closer to reaching our benchmarks and our targets. But right now, we have adopted and you guys have basically accepted through the budget that 15% of our free cash would go towards the rainy day fund until we hit that target. So,
okay. And I'm assuming that these funds all generate interest.
They'll generate interest, and all the interest is a lot of the general monies in the city. All that interest goes to the general fund. It's interest income. It goes in as a local receipt. But when we adopt these stabilization accounts, one function of the law is that the interest stays
with the
funds.
With the account. Yes. What kind of interest are being generated off of these accounts?
They could be anywhere from, we have a mix of CDs. We have some staggered CDs. We'll do a 6 month, a 12 month, an 18 month, a 24 okay. month, and we'll roll them. And we also have some money invested in some very, very, very low risk AAA bond type things. And I think we try to get a 4% return on any money we put in the market. Say 70-80% of that is usually AAA rated bonds and stuff. So we're not out buying into that stock right. or anything like that. I mean, the treasurer is the custodian of the funds, and I oversee the treasurer, and we take a very, very, very conservative approach with this money. I would never want to come before sure. you and see this money yeah. go.
Absolutely.
It kind of bothers me sometimes when I'm only making a percent on $10 million, but I also
but
would
you know,
feel.
But you know that there's a gain.
That's
there,
right.
There's not going to be a shortfall.
Yeah.
Is there any portion of the funds that are invested in anything that would be slightly more risky than, you know, guarantees just about?
Not in this fund.
Okay.
Not in the rainy day fund.
All right.
In the OPEB trust, and we have a little more because that money is not.
Sure.
Can never be drawn off. So we have it a little bit slighter, riskier stuff. But most of it is in very secure, AAA rated or cash or CDs or guaranteed returns. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
From the chair, a quick question. CDs. Now, obviously, you're not going through our local banks, right? You're going through commercial banks with those? Are these more jumbo CDs?
No, we go to local banks. We like to keep business local. We have CDs with local banks.
Okay. And what type of interest rate are we looking at there?
Again, right now the interest rate could be anywhere from 60 basis points to a percent and a half. You probably know that interest rates are pretty low right now.
Well, that's why I'm asking.
Yeah.
Yeah, they've actually been down for a while.
Yeah.
I was just kind of curious.
We beat them up a bit, and we try to get, you know, there's not a lot of wiggle room in the guaranteed CD market out there right now, but again, it's secure money, and I don't want to risk losing any of the principal on this money.
No, the principal's definitely protected here. What kind of amounts are put into these CDs? Let's just take one CD, for example. So
$2 million.
Okay.
$2 million, you know, ladder them.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Whatever the balance is.
That sparked one other question. Of this 10.6, how much of that money is held locally in local banks?
10.6.
The whole thing? Nothing wrong with being a hometown player. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Councilor Hanlon, did you have a question?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We're talking about $10 million and $14 million as if it's just, you know, nothing. And I'm wondering, is there a limit on how much we can put into a stabilization account? I mean, before the states come and say, you guys got $100 million in there, that's kind of dumb, you know?
You know, I don't know the answer to that question, but I can find out.
I think...
That'd be a great problem.
I think I know it would be, you know.
But I don't know the answer.
Anyone of us should question, you know, see, that's a lot of money that you have in there, and it's I know it's gaining interest and everything, you know, but maybe it could be used for something better. And I don't know what, so I'm not pushing for anything or anything like that, but, you know, I just wonder if there's a cap that we should put on it or that has to be put on it.
I'll find out for you,
thank
but
you.
I don't know.
So very good.
I don't think we're at it.
I don't think so either. Because somebody would have said something already.
Any further questions? Excuse me.
Second.
Thanks.
For thank real. You.
Your pleasure.
For the item out, favorable actions.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion recommended favorable action and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion to adjourn?
No, Mr. Chairman, will we revert back to the item number one in the back room?
Do I have a second? So moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?